You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Well, good morning. I hope I have a lot of you out there for our review session. I think that'll be great. So far, we have, I think, five people or seven people watching live. That's good. It's probably a record. Here's what's going to happen today. I'm going to talk about the exam, the structure of the exam, how it's going to work, and then I'm going to go over the answers to the 15 sample questions that I put at the end of the study guide. For all those of you who have actually looked at the study guide, I'm sorry I'm very cynical today. I'll try not to be. And then I'll entertain questions, and you can get questions on the screen for the whole class. AskDHTV live@gmail.com. You send a question in, it'll appear on the screen in front of me right down here. And as soon as I get a moment, I will answer that question. I'll even break into what I'm saying to answer the question. So let me talk about the exam. The best way to see the talk about the exam is for me to go to the study guide at the top. The exam is Thursday. We have the review session today, and I'll answer all your questions. It says midterm, but it's really not a midterm, it's just an exam. The exam opens at 7 a.m. and ends at 11:59 p.m. From the time you start taking the exam, you have 1 hour and 15 minutes to take the test. You can use anything you want, any resources except other people. Obviously, I have no way of knowing whether you're going to use other people or not. I'm just assuming you're going to try to be honest and do it on your own. That means you can have your study guides, you can have all the PowerPoints open on the screen, which I highly recommend that you have them all open. Have your study guide. I don't know how you've done the study guide, but I'm going to give you some suggestions. And George, our TA, gave you some suggestions on what to do. The exam has 50 multiple choice questions, including everything that I talked about, specific topics in the book that I listed below, and your exam is going to be unique. I'll explain to you how I did this. I wrote about 150 questions, I think, all together for the exam. They're in three categories. One category I call thinking questions, and I'll show you examples of that when I go through all the questions. One category I call factual. Actually, I don't call them factual, and I really call them barf questions, because they're the kind that you should just either know the answer or you don't, and you just barf it out. Those are the ones that should take you 5 seconds to find the right answer. And then 10 questions from the book. The 20 questions, the thinking questions, will come out of a pool of about 50 questions. Actually, probably even more. The 20 factual questions come out of a large pool. The 10 questions from the book come out of a large pool. So everybody will get a different test. The tests are all comparable. The test is worth 30% of your grade. I'm on a 0 to 1,000 point scale, so it's worth 300 points. That means that each of your 50 questions eventually counts as 6 points. When you get your score, what you'll see is your score out of 50. If you want to know your score out of 300, you just multiply it by 6. A couple things about the test. When you log on to Blackboard, what you're going to see is an announcement. There'll be a new announcement, and in that announcement, I will put a link to the test. You may see something that says exams. That's also another way to get there, but I will put a link to the test there, and the test, once you click on the test, it will start. It will put all 50 questions on the screen for you at the same time. It's like having a real test in class. What that means is that you can answer them one at a time. You can go through and answer them in order or out of order. When you answer a question, on the right-hand side of the screen, there'll be a little check mark that says saved. If it doesn't say saved, sometimes I notice when I was taking the tests, it didn't say save. It takes a few seconds to say save. And if it doesn't, just click save answer. And if you're not sure, at the very top of the screen, there's something that says question completion status. If you click on that, it shows you 50 questions, little boxes, and every one that you've answered, it's grayed in. It looks like I have a question from Emily today. I have a question from a non-TA who says, will lecture today go the full 75 minutes? I sure hope so, because that means there's lots of questions from you. I have a question from Emily that says, this study guide is packed with a lot of information. Yes, Emily, it is. My question is, will the test questions be fairly linear and in the order they appear on the study guide so we won't be jumping around? Nope. The questions are randomized. So sorry, Emily, but they're all randomized, but you can answer them in any order you'd like. So you want to go through and look at all the questions that are on the book. It'll usually say, the question will say, according to the book, or according to a chapter in the book, or according to the book and the lecture, blah, blah, blah. So you can answer those. You can go back and forth. Whatever you want to do is fine. So back to the instructions. I think it's clear, unless you've filed with DSS, and those of you who have with Disabled Student Services, I will email you separately to remind you that you get whatever extra time that you're allowed through Disabled Student Services. I think we just have a few this semester. You have 75 minutes to take the test. There are 50 questions, so that's about a minute, roughly a minute a question. I highly recommend that the way you take the test is the same way you take a test in a classroom, is that you go through, you answer all the questions. Perhaps you keep a piece of paper next to you to list the questions that you want to go back to, because on what I tell students in class is, on a regular test, circle the question that you need to go back to make sure you get it right. You go back and forth, and you answer all the questions, and at the very end, you go through and click on that thing at the top that says question completion status and make sure that all 50 are grayed in, that you actually answered all 50. I understand, this is the first time I've ever done this, but I understand as soon as you click submit your test at the bottom, or as soon as time runs out, it will tell you the score you got on the test. I am not sure about that, but I think that's what I've been told. I guess we're all learning about this. I think it'll tell you when you started, when you stopped, and what score you got out of 50. Do remember, and this is very important, do remember that my grading scale is different. 90% is an A. I really believe if you're going to get an A in my class, you need to get 90%. So that would be 45 out of 50. 75% is a B, because my tests tend to be a little harder than normal tests, so I drop my B from 80 to 75. That means 37.5 out of 50 is a B. 60% is a C, which means 30 out of the 50 is all you need to get a C. And then 50% is a D, 25 out of 50. Interestingly enough, just as an aside, in my normal classes when I teach these live in the theater, the average is usually 35 out of 50. I'm very interested to see how people do. We have a little betting contest in our lab. Everybody's guessing what the average will be, and so I'm betting on 35. I'm hoping that I can count on all of you out there to really work hard and study. So let me talk a little bit before we get started and I go through some things, and I'll entertain questions at any time. Here's the way I would study, and I've actually told this live to some people, and I've talked to George about this. Before I do that, Violetta says, for whatever reason, are we able to save our answers and log back in at a later time and continue with the saved answers? Yes and no. I don't know how the timer works, but I've been told that it's best for you to simply answer everything, and if for some reason you need to log on off, log right back on as soon as possible. It should save all the answers to that point. But this is all new for me, too. I believe that that's true, though, that it will save your answers and you can log back in. Jennifer's asking a question about the material. What is catfishing? Can you explain more deeply about it? That's a question from the book. I talked about it briefly in class. That is where somebody portrays themselves as something different. It often happens on social media. It used to happen a lot on online dating sites, where you'd be looking at the online dating sites, you'd find somebody you were interested in communicating with, based on their picture and what they wrote. So you'd communicate with them either by email when it first started, and then all of a sudden you'd get the idea that you wanted to meet, and they would stall you and stall you and stall you and maybe ask for money because they were in a different state and they needed a plane flight or whatever. And you'd either never meet them, or it would turn out that it wasn't, if you were talking to a woman, it wasn't a woman at all, it was a man. If you thought you were talking to a 25-year-old, it was really a 75-year-old. So catfishing is, that's what it is. Myra asks, hello, I was wondering if there will be any extra credit questions on the exam. So sorry, Myra, there will be other extra credit in the class, but no, it's too complicated to put extra credit on the exams. Don't worry about it. My grading scale is designed to be pretty flexible, and don't worry about it. So before I get to any more questions, let me continue to talk about how I would study for this. The best way to study is to start with the study guide. The study guide lists all the topics that are possible for questions. And the way I wrote the questions is I had the study guide in front of me, and I sat there and I looked at the first issue on the study guide, and I wrote a question or three questions or five questions or whatever for the pool of questions. So I went through the study guide to ask the questions. What I would do if I were you is print out the study guide, or it's easier to print out and handwrite it, I think, but that's just my way I handle it. Or you can take the Word document study guide and type what you think the answers are. And if you don't want to type out all the answers, what you should do is type out where you can find the answers. Like, for example, there'll be some questions from the very first generation lecture, or one of the generation lectures, where I showed a bunch of graphs comparing the generations. I don't know if you remember that. Some of the graphs look like this. 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 You don't want to be writing all that stuff down, but what you can write is the information about how different generations do X, Y, and Z can be found on PowerPoint lecture on this date and these slides. So you don't have to go searching through, because you only have 75 minutes to answer 50 questions. Let's see, I've got a couple questions. Danielle says, two questions. I don't know, Danielle, it should cost you extra for two questions. Now, along with Emily's question, I know you said questions are out of order, but is there anything that is not on the study guide that we need to look at? Nope. Everything that you need to look at is on the study guide. What chapters are contained in this test? Well, if you look at the study guide and you go to the bottom of the study guide, as I'm scrolling down to the bottom of the study guide, you see textbook-specific chapters, chapter 1, chapter 4, chapter 9, and chapter 10. You would know that if you looked at the syllabus, because it shows what chapters. But I don't need you to know everything. I've listed everything I want you to know in chapter 1, everything I want you to know in chapter 4, which, by the way, includes catfishing, everything I want you to know in chapter 9, everything I want you to know in chapter 10 is far less than what's there. Alyssa asked a question, what are the main themes of the segment we watched called Brain Hacking? The answer is, go look at the very first lecture. At the very end of the lecture, there's a link to the Brain Hacking, and that's what you need to look at to answer that question. Stephanie asks on, this is great, we're getting questions. Stephanie asks on chapter 9, what is social comparison theory? It's in the book, and there's quite a bit of information on it, but I'll give you a real brief answer since you're asking. Social comparison theory, the way I like to liken it is, imagine that you are on Facebook still. And I know most everybody here is on Facebook, but you don't use it much anymore. So imagine you're on Facebook and you're following someone, and they're maybe an old friend of yours that went to high school with you, and they're posting wonderful things about what they're doing, parties they're going to, trips they're going on, family they have, boyfriends, girlfriends, whatever. And what happens is you compare yourself to them and make judgments about yourself and your self-worth, your self-efficacy, based on comparing to some other person. So that's what social comparison theory says. It often leads, by the way, to envy and jealousy, as you read about in the book and as we talked about in lecture. But part of that is a little illusory, because you know that people mostly post positive things about themselves on social media. They don't typically post oh, I stumbled today and broke my leg. Well, they might, because they're gloating about breaking their leg, but they might not say, oh, I said a stupid thing to a friend today. Those kind of things they wouldn't post. So when you look at social media, you're really looking at somebody posting what kind of sense of self, by the way? That should be a good test question. What kind of sense of self is somebody posting on social media that makes them look really, really good and that you want to compare yourself to them? That's one of the questions in here. So let me go down to the very bottom of the study guide and let me go through the 15 questions so you can get a sense of the kind of questions that we ask. Let's make this bigger so I can read them one at a time. There, that should be good on your screen. So the first question says, Melvin is 30 years old and has watched a lot of porn since he was a teenager. Over time, he has slowly developed the attitude that all women just want to have sex. Which of the following theories best explains this? So this is an example of a thinking question, one of those thinking questions, where I've given you a scenario, and I've asked you then to take this scenario and draw a conclusion from it. And you will see lots of these on the test because I like writing them. So-and-so is 12 years old, blah, blah, blah. So-and-so is this. So I'm not going to tell you at this point, make you, if I were doing this in class live, I would ask for a show of hands of what the right answer is. But the right answer on this one is cultivation theory. How do we know it's cultivation theory? The key is right here where it says over time. Over time is what cultivation theory is. It's your attitudes, your behaviors being honed over a long period of time. Why isn't it, say, script theory? Because you're not working from a script. You may have developed a script over time, but the development is what cultivation theory talks about. Why is it not social learning theory? Because you're not comparing yourself to other people. And why is it not general learning theory? Because we haven't really talked about it. So question two, in a study discussed in class, people from different generations were examined to determine what other activities were considered similar to using Facebook. That was one of the early lectures. And that was the one where I showed Facebook hopping around from one place to the other. Interestingly, while the net generation sees Facebook as blank, the I generation sees it as blank. So I'm not going to answer this question because I want you to go back and look this up. And I feel like if I answer this one, you won't go back and look it up. So we'll leave that one for you guys, but this is not a thinking question. This is really a barf question. This is a question asking you to just know where to go. So this is one of those ones where I would be on my study guide, have this as lecture whatever, slide whatever, slides whatever. It's a series of slides. And you can guess the answer. I'll let you guess the answer on this. Number three, this is purely a barf question. Which psychologist looks at the development of our sense of self as a series of stages where we face a crisis such as trust and mistrust or autonomy versus shame? This is actually the wrong question. I should just write, I'm going to stop this question right there and get rid of that part of the question, and now you can answer it. Which of psychologists looks at the development of our sense of self as a series of stages where we face a crisis? And the answer is James Marcia. If I'd asked about which psychologist looks at the sense of self as ideal self, real self, and ought self, it would be Carl Rogers. If I asked which psychologist looks at sense of self as us being actors on a stage, then it would be Irving Goffman. That was a question I actually stole from previous semester, where actually the real answer was Eric Erickson, by the way. Number four, in my study of generational differences in values, I showed how political beliefs have been changing. This graph shows which of the following, a straight line increasing from baby boomers to Generation C, start low, then increase, then decrease, then increase, then decrease, a straight line decreasing for baby boomers to Generation C, or a flat line? And I hope you know the answer to that is B. That's an example of one of those yo-yo patterns where the generations yo-yo back and forth, where one generation holds, say, a very liberal attitude, then the next generation holds a more conservative attitude, and then the next generation a more liberal, and then more conservative. So it's a yo-yoing back and forth line. Number five, April has been talked, this is another thinking question. April has been talking to Jennifer, who's a friend of a friend on Facebook. They seem to hit it off and decide to get together and hang out. April's all excited as she feels Jennifer really understands her and will be a great friend. When they meet, Jennifer is shy and quiet and not very friendly. This is a problem with, and this is an exact answer that's of projection. We talked about this briefly in class, but projection is where you project what you want someone to be, how you want someone to be based on your assumptions. And what April has done is made assumptions of Jennifer such that she's assumed that Jennifer's going to be a certain way, and she is in fact not. And that's not Jennifer's problem, it's April's problem of projecting on Jennifer what she wants her to be. I always tell this story when I teach this part of the class. Can we come back to me for a second? I know they're so excited to have these questions on the screen. Ah, thank you, hi, I'm back. I always tell this question on me. I've mentioned in here that I met my fiance on online dating years ago, years being 15 years ago. When I started online dating, I was very interested in a few women that I was corresponding with, and I was emailing with a couple women at a time. And one was a professor at a local college, and she was an attorney, and she taught law. And I thought, well, that's pretty good. I'm a teacher. I teach psychology. We'll get along. She was very witty. Her emails were very charming. And so, of course, what you do with online dating is you arrange for a coffee date. So we met somewhere close to where she worked, and I sat down and tried to have a conversation, but she couldn't put two words together, and she talked like this, really soft, and she really had zero personality. And what I realized later is that I had projected what I wanted her to be from her emails, and a lot of people are very good on email but not very good face to face. And it turned out I thought, well, this person on email is witty and charming and smart and everything. And so I made her into witty, charming, and smart when in fact I projected all over her. So anyway, that's just a little story. Number six, when you're talking to someone via text message, you have to try to figure out their blank in order to help you better understand their message. I hope you know the answer to this is context. It is the major part of the five C's of communication. It's in the center. It is the most important one. That is just sort of a combination I would call a thinking question, but really a barf question, but I think it's kind of a thinking question. Number seven, when children are exposed to, this is a barf question, definitely. When children were exposed to videos of cartoon characters fighting, then allowed to play with a Bobo doll, they let other children play with the Bobo doll first, wanted to play with the Bobo doll, but chose a truck instead, refused to play at all and sat in a corner biting their fingernails, hit the Bobo doll a lot. The answer is hit the Bobo doll a lot. Even if it's remember the study on the Bobo doll is even if it's cartoon characters or real people that they watch fighting, it doesn't really matter. They still went and hit the Bobo doll. Another barf question, when 50 million people use a technology, it's considered to become part of society. This is called the penetration rate, D. That's just a barf question. You either know it or not. Number nine, Vincent, another, I love writing questions about kids and porn. I don't know why, it's just they're very interesting questions to write. Vincent watches a lot of porn. When he looks at profiles of women on Match.com, which of the following is most likely to be his attitude based on the research results we've discussed in class? A, I'm sure that none of these women will like me. B, none of these women are pretty. C, this is a great idea and fun to be able to see so many women to date. D, I'm nervous to contact any of these women. And the answer is B, because porn makes you become jaded to people's looks and to start to look at women as objects. Here's another barf question. The two dimensions of communication are, I hope you know the answer to this in poof, 1 second, synchronicity and cues. Here's another thinking question. Jackson and his dad Merrill worked at the same company. They attended a morning meeting, and after the meeting, Merrill got angry with Jackson because Jackson was checking his phone constantly during the meeting while Merrill was paying complete attention. Merrill is most likely from the blank generation, while Jackson is most likely from the blank. So what's the answer? Well, first of all, Merrill was paying complete attention and liked meetings, so that makes him a baby boomer. So far now we've lopped out B and C. Which is correct for Jackson? Is he most likely a net genner, or is he most likely Generation C? And in order to answer this question, you actually have to realize that he couldn't be working in the same company and be a Gen C, so the most likely answer is a net generation. 12, Elizabeth is so frustrated with her boyfriend. This is another kind of thinking question. So frustrated with her boyfriend, she wants to go to a movie and texted him with some choices. He texted back, okay. In terms of the five C's of communication, the problem lies with, it's not connection, they're connecting via text. It's not content, she's very clear about the content. It's not context, it's completion. Okay is not completing her question of which movie he wanted to go to. Number 13, we're getting close to the end here. Which of the following would you expect to find if you looked at a narcissist's Facebook page? This is really a barf question because I gave lots of research about what you would see, what narcissists do on Facebook. So which answer is that? Certainly not rare status updates. Narcissists update their status all the time. Narcissists have lots of friends. Narcissists always have a posed profile picture, and they don't have pictures of other people. 14, which theory includes the concepts of bonding, bridging, and maintaining? That is a barf question, and that is social capital theory. That is actually both in the book and in the lecture. So you've got it in both places, and you should be able to find that answer. And then last question, this I would call, well, I'll just read it and then I'll tell you. John basically lives on social media. He rarely sees friends live, but does talk to them online all day and night. Lately, he's been feeling kind of depressed and has been posting about his sad and lonely feelings. He is getting comments from people that are positive and are reflecting virtual empathy. We talked about virtual empathy, and there's a ton of stuff in the book on virtual empathy. One of his online friends who is worried comes to his house and gives him a hug. How many of these online comments would it take for him to feel as supported as he felt from that one hug? So this becomes a barf question. It's directly from the book and the lecture, 5 to 6. So those are the questions. At this point, there is information up here on what you should know from each lecture, and the lectures are in order, so you can go through. From the opening lecture, there's just a couple of things. Sorry if you didn't watch the brain hacking. Gotta watch it if you want to answer a question about it. And I'm sure there's a question on there, I hope. Maybe, maybe not. You might get it, you might not. Lecture on generational differences, I've listed the things that are important. I don't expect you to memorize these things. That's why you get to have all your notes there. You get to have all the PowerPoints. You just need to know where to find them and what they mean. And I would be writing, for example, Toffler's models of waves of technology, including my extrapolation of the next wavelets. What is a wavelet? I would be writing right here, type in, Toffler had these waves and you and Rosen added these wavelets. Lecture on technology used across generations. There were a lot of graphs in there. You really don't need to memorize all the graphs, but you need to know where they are in case you need to find the answer for a barf question. Lecture on communication, we talked about cues and synchronicity and context and the five C's of communication, all of these issues. I mean, there's a lot of stuff to know. I pack you with stuff, sorry. Trying to get you a lot of material and get your brain thinking. Lecture on sexuality and internet addiction. Just need to go through, there's a few categories in there, things that you need to know. The online dating study that we did with those fun messages from different people. Lecture on family systems and parenting, and I talked a bunch about what a system is, and then the different parts of family system, and then I ended with models of parenting. The lecture on technology and health, we talked a lot about what the effect of technology is on health, what television is on health. We talked about mental health, physical health, narcissistic personality disorder, etc. And then at the end, we'd had two lectures on how the brain works and models of memory. And you'll notice that it goes through N there because there's a lot of material in those two lectures. So you can expect that the more material from a lecture, the more questions. From the textbook, there's only chapters 1, 4, 9, and 10. And I've only really listed a couple of topics from there. And I've listed them in order as they appear in the chapter. So you should start with on chapter one, the HomeNet project. That's the case study. At the beginning of every chapter, there's a case study. You need to read it and figure out what it is. The book talks about disinhibition. We've talked about it in class. The book talks about mixed media relationships, which we haven't. The book talks about social capital, virtual empathy, social displacement theory, the iPhone effect, impact of playing violent video games on empathy and desensitization, which we talked about in class also. Chapter four starts with case study on catfishing and then talks about sexting research. At the end of every chapter is an interview with someone who is well-known in the field. You should read those interviews because questions can also come from those interviews. Chapter nine is more about emotions and talks about positive and negative emotions. At the end of the chapter, there's an interview with Dr. Megan Moreno about that. Oh, Myra's come up. I'm curious to know if anyone has ever gotten a perfect score on my exams. Yes, George got one once, right? One of my tests. Yes, you can get a perfect score. In fact, I'm hoping there will be lots of perfect scores. I would love one day to have everybody get a perfect score. Maybe my last class that I teach next spring before I officially retire. I don't know. I have a question from Alyssa. The research on sexting, positives and negatives. There were quite a bit of negatives. Should we note all of them from the reading, or is there something we should focus on specifically? That's a very good question, Alyssa. I would match the positives and negatives with what I said in class, and that would probably be the stuff that you want to highlight, but I would also try to make sure that you know exactly where the material is in the book, what page number, or have little post-it notes sticking out, but probably just the page number will work, and make sure that you know where that material is. Gabriella asked, what does the Common Sense Media study show in terms of communication changes between 2012 and 2018? That's a reasonable question. And the answer is there's two graphs that I showed you. One was a graph that looked at preferred method of communicating with your friend by teenagers. And in 2012, it was face-to-face. And in 2018, it was, I hope all of you are saying texting, because it was texting. And then in 2000, there was a second graph that showed people who visited social media sites at least once a day. 2012, it was like 35%, I think, and 2000, or 30% maybe even. In 2018, it was 70%, showing that there's a lot more time spent on social media. Jackie asked, can you explain gratifications again? Yes, I will. This is a theory that comes from television viewing. It's really technically called uses and gratifications. And what it looks at is what is behind us using a particular website, a particular type of phone, a particular device, a particular social media site, particular YouTube videos. And the answer is we use something because we get some sort of gratification. I would say the gratification for most people for using YouTube is often entertainment. That would be a gratification. I get entertained by doing that. Knowledge. I read the news a lot. Why do I read it? I read it for a sense of knowledge, to know what's going on with the world, to know who's making idiotic statements today. A lot of people follow Twitter, and they follow specific people. Why do they follow it? Some people follow it for knowledge. Some people follow it for entertainment. Some people follow it for humor value. Some people follow it to just keep up and be able to discuss the material and sound smart. There are lots of reasons why you do that. Nasser says, do you recommend rewatching all the lectures, or if possible, we will find some answer through the PowerPoints? That's a good question. If you've watched the lecture once, I think if you understood the lecture completely and you followed the PowerPoints, because I show the PowerPoints during the lecture, then what I would do is go back to the PowerPoint itself from that lecture, look at it, see if there's points that you might have missed watching YouTube. Because quite honestly, and this is going to be part of a reaction paper later on this semester, I know you're really not paying total attention when you're watching the lecture on YouTube. Nobody out there can tell me that they don't get distracted. Whether you get distracted, we're going to talk about a lot of this after the exam. If you get distracted from outside, from notifications from your phone, and you keep the YouTube video running in the background, or if, as people have told me, they run it at 2.0 speed, you might not maybe get everything out of there. I would look at the PowerPoint and see what you missed, and then go back and watch those sections. If you have time, rewatching all the videos is great, but I don't think you have time. Emily says, I'm sorry, Emily. I don't remember off the top of my head, was the brain hacking the video you were featured in initially showed us in the first lecture? Yes, it's the 60 Minutes video. And it's really an important one to watch now, because it formed the beginning of the class and it's going to be toward the end of the class again. I'm not going to show the video, but I'm going to talk a lot about the ramifications of what's in that video and what it means for us now as we use technology, and what it might mean for us in the future, what it means for our kids, what it means for our families. So yes, it's very important. I wouldn't have shown that whole thing if I didn't think it was critical for you to know. Gabriella says, what trends are seen when you track the use of different technologies across different generations using self-report data? There are lots of trends, Gabriella. One of the things that I showed is some of the trends go straight up, that successive generations are using, for example, more and more social media. Trends go down, that baby boomers use more email. Generation X uses less email. Net Generation X uses even less email. So there were particular trends, and I actually have just a few slides because I crammed a bunch of similar trends all on the same slides. But you could probably infer most of these trends from what you know out in the real world. But it's really good for you to just at least take a look at those trends, mark where they are, note when that they're slides X, Y, and Z on this day's lecture, and you'll do great. You can look it up really quickly. I don't see any more questions. Are there any more questions coming in? Give people a few seconds to ask questions. Let me remind you again how the test is going to go. When you log on to Blackboard sometime Thursday, by the way, there's no lecture on Thursday. I wouldn't require you to watch a lecture and have to take a test. When you get on there, there will be an announcement at the top. The announcement will be at the top, and what the announcement will say is click here to get the test, and it'll take you right to the exam, and then you can click and start it. Jackie says, which chapter would you say is the most important? That's a good question. Let me go back to the chapters. Let's see, chapter one. Okay, chapter 4, less important. Chapter 9, probably chapters 1 and 10 are the most important. I mean, if I were apportioning, if I had an hour to read those chapters, first of all, an hour is not enough, but if I had an hour to read those chapters, I'd probably apportion more to chapter 1 and chapter 10. I'm waiting for more questions. I feel like I'm on a telethon, you know, like Jerry Lewis muscular dystrophy telethon. Please call in with your pledges. We have people waiting to take your phone calls, and there'll be a bank of people behind me, all with phones to their ears talking. Blah, 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 a lot of famous people. They're telling me that I have 27 minutes left, but that's actually not true. That's not true. I have more than 27 minutes left. They're going to change the time, and the note on the screen says, whoops. This class, as you all know, cuts across two modules on this campus. Normal campus classes go from 10 to 11:15 or 11:30 to 12:45, so it's bewildering all of us. So Myra asks, I have a question about our reaction paper too. Once we have our 7 days, do we send the data to you, or do we collect until the 7th? You can send it at any time. The last day to send it in is the 7th. It doesn't really matter. I think the more data you collect, the better off you'll be answering questions A, B, and C, because the more stable your data will be. So if you started collecting the first day, keep collecting and send it in the 5th, 6th, 7th, whenever. And don't forget that you're going to keep that app running in the background. We've discovered magically that those of you who have an iPhone with iOS we'll be able to use screen time to create your own diary. I'm going to be posting a handout on how to do that, hopefully later today, thanks to Jen for helping us figure that out. There's another question, let's see, from Jackie. Can you go over the brain handling various tasks again? I'm not sure what you're asking about, Jackie, but there are different systems in the brain that handle different tasks. If you're asking from chapter, where? It's in one of the chapters. Now I can't find it. I don't know. I don't know where it is, but it also was in one of my lectures. There's parts of the brain that we deal with. The prefrontal cortex is really important. I talked about that. It's the seat of executive functions. It holds where your attention, your working memory when you're working on a problem in your head, either an emotional problem or a physical problem like a math problem or a emotional problem that you're having. You're working on your head, working memory handles that. It's up here. Impulsivity, the decision to multitask, all of those things are up here. Behind there is something called the amygdala, which is the seat of emotions, as well as the limbic system, which includes the amygdala, is the seat of emotions. I've talked a lot about different chemicals, different hormones, different molecules that come. We talked about, I believe we talked about sleep, right? Did we talk about sleep? Yeah. Talked about melatonin coming from the pineal gland. I talked about cortisol coming from and adrenaline coming from the adrenal gland. So those are the main systems. I get a question, who is the scientist who is studying the sexting the most? I'm not going to answer that question, but I will give you a hint. The hint is go look at the chapter that has sexting and go look at the Q&A at the end. We talk to the scientist who is the expert at sexting, so very easy to answer that one yourself. Veronica asks, what are some of the privacy issues in communication? That's really important because we have this sort of false illusion about privacy, that everything we say is private. And one of the things we've learned over the years from studying this is that nothing is private. In one of my books, one of my early books, I wrote a quote from an FBI agent who said, you should think about anything that you write on the internet as being tattooed on your forehead. I always thought that was a pretty good way to look at it, that even if you think it's temporary, even if you are Donald Trump and you post a tweet and then you immediately take it off, 4,000 people have seen that tweet, copied and pasted it someplace, written it down, whatever, it's now permanent. It's now been disseminated elsewhere or retweeted it or whatever. You can't stop that. And so privacy in communication is that when you have a communication between people and you're using a modality that is public in some sense, then there is no privacy. And so part of the issue is you need to consider privacy in your communication and make sure that you're not saying things there that are going to embarrass you later or get you in trouble later. And we all know all the stories about idiots who text dick pics and idiots who say things on Twitter that they know they shouldn't say and get exposed. I never understand that. But Jackie has a question. Distractions, dreaming. Jackie, that I don't understand what you're asking. What does distraction dreaming mean? I'm sorry. It's two topics. I don't really understand what a question. Question from the TA from George. Here's a tip for the night before. Don't cram. Get a good night's sleep. And that comes straight from our sleep lecture. We do know that if you get a bad night's sleep, if you don't have a good night's sleep, if you don't use your sleep cycles well, if you study right up to the last minute and your device is right in front of your face, and you're getting cortisol flooding into your head, you're not going to get a good night's sleep. You're not going to learn as well. Your brain doesn't consolidate the information you just studied. Basically, you just wasted time. Martin has three questions. I don't know, one per character. We'll give you all three of them anyway. What are the unique characteristics of the I generation and the upcoming generation C? That's a good question. It's in the handout, or it's in the PowerPoint, but I am going to tell you because I think that the I generation and generation C are very unique. One, they are, what can I say? They are very social. They're a very social generation. They're also a very connected generation, meaning they connect and they use a lot of different modalities to connect. They also share a core value of believing that anything that can be done can be done. Anything that they dream up can be done. And then if you go back and look at the PowerPoint slide, you'll see that there are other values in there that are unique to those both of those generations. Second question on here, he says, what is a cohort? That's a good question. Those are people that grow up with you at the same time. So my cohort, I was born in 1950. My cohort are all those people who grew up, you know, in the late 40s, early 50s, mid 50s. They share the common music with me. I know that I have friends who are in their 70s, and when I talk to them about some of the music that I listened to when I was growing up, the Beatles, Rolling Stones, whatever, they go, "Oh, I was more of a Pete Seeger fan, or a Woody Guthrie fan, or a Patti Page fan." So I know that we're not cohorts. We're not cohorts musically. And then rapid pace of new technology since the new millennium. That's the slide that I gave you of how long it takes, how long it takes an idea, a device, a web app, a phone app to reach 50 million users, and that's expanding rapidly. And the two examples I gave of how fast they're expanding now are, what were the two examples? Pokemon Go was one, and Angry Birds was another. I think Angry Birds took a little over a month to hit 50 million people, and Pokemon Go took something like 19 days or something like that. So new technologies come every day. I mean, one of my kids asked me the other day to send them some money on, they owed me some money, and they said, "Should I Venmo you?" And I said, "What?" I said, "I know what Venmo is, but I'm not doing it. PayPal me." So all these technologies, Venmo's very new. All this stuff is new. And of course, the younger generations are the ones that use them most. Other questions? Thanks for your three questions, Martin. I appreciate it. Well, while I'm waiting for other questions, and by the way, thank you all for being there and asking your questions. I appreciate it. Hopefully the other people will hear the answers and will be helped enormously. Again, let me remind you a couple things about studying for this test. Use the study guide. Use the study guide. Use the study guide. Use it as a piece of note paper. Write all over it. Type all over it. Do whatever you want. Just make sure that you know the answer to each of the questions on the study guide. Or if you don't know the answer, you know exactly where to find them. Lecture date and slide numbers will help you find it immediately. When you take the test, you're going to have all 50 questions on the screen at the same time. You don't have to answer them in order. I recommend that you start in order, keep a piece of paper to the side, write down any questions you want to go back and reconsider, answer all the ones you know now, and then go back and answer. You should be able to answer most of those barf questions, by the way, most of those factual questions pretty easily. The thinking questions you might have some problems with. Violetta, I hope I pronounced the name right, asks, are there going to be any questions that ask definitions of certain terms, or will they all be scenarios? As I mentioned before, 20 of the 50 questions will be scenarios, 20 of the 50 questions will be factual or barf questions, and 10 will be from the book. So hopefully that answered your question. More on how to study. You certainly have to have watched all the lectures. That's like a given. I'm assuming that if you really just looked at the PowerPoints, you might be able to get a high D. That's sort of my guess, if you just looked at the PowerPoints. If you haven't looked at any, watched any of the lectures, shame on you. Shame on you. You can't watch them all the last day. Don't try to sit down for 8 hours tomorrow and try to watch all the lectures. Your brain won't be able to assimilate it. You know that from everything that we've been talking about in this class. Your brain won't be able to assimilate it. Watch a lecture. Go look at the study guide. Write down what you remember. Go look at the PowerPoint. Write down what you remember. The PowerPoints are all there in PowerPoint format. You can write notes below each slide if you want. Alyssa's asking, problematic internet usage and effects on parenting. I noticed parental monitoring, mediation, estimates of teen internet time, etc. I'm not sure what the second part is that you noted, but PIU, problematic internet usage, has been shown in one of the studies that we talked about to have a negative impact on parenting. And we talked about parents not really being aware of how much time their kids are spending on their devices, and also not being very good at parenting around those devices, around their use, around punishment. A lot of parents just take away the device, and that doesn't really affect the kid because they still have multiple other devices that they can connect with. Parents don't seem to set rules and guidelines yet. We talked a lot about that. Just seems important. Another question from Nasser. Can we expect any true false questions? Nope. Thanks for asking. Everything's multiple choice. Four answers only. There will not be any of the all of the above or none of the above. There won't be those. Lynette asks, how do different generations perceive Facebook differently? I will direct you back to the PowerPoints, Lynette, where in the PowerPoints, I did this thing where I showed each generation, and I showed the three different categories, groupings, how each generation kind of thought that different technologies grouped together. And I showed, and you might remember that in the middle was always what I called couch potato activities, which was watching TV and playing video games for almost every generation. And then the far right grouping was always, far right grouping, I don't know which way you're seeing it on the screen, the far grouping, my right, your left, whatever. The far right grouping was always the communication ones, and the far left grouping was always the general technology ones. So go back and look and see, and you'll be able to answer those questions. We seem to have run out of questions. Give people another couple seconds to ask. Otherwise, thank you for those of you who've been asking questions. You'll notice that I'm not answering every question directly, but I am telling you where to go to find the answers for those questions. And I think that's important, particularly for studying for the test. Again, what's really important is going through and making sure that you know everything, the answers to everything on the study guide, either what the answer is or where to find it. That's critical. Take those questions at the end and make sure you can answer all 15 of those questions and you know why. They're a good example of questions other than one from the book. I didn't put any on the book. I just stole questions from a previous exam, I think from last year's exam or the year before or something. That's why that Eric Erickson question showed up. So if we have no other questions, I think we'll stop for the day. I have office hours this afternoon. I think at 2:15, 2:30, somewhere around there, if you want to stop by. You can always email myself or George, and we won't tell you the answers to things, but we might tell you where to find them. So again, tests on Thursday. No excuse for not taking the test. No excuse for starting it at 11:50 and only having 9 minutes. The test will die. It will open at 7 a.m. There'll be an announcement on your Blackboard page, and you'll get emailed the announcement also, telling you where to click to go to the exam. There'll be instructions for the exam. All 50 questions will be on the screen at the same time. Feel free to go back and forth. I encourage you to answer all the ones you know first, and then go back, and at the very end, make sure that you pull down the screen at the top that says, I forget what it says, but it'll tell you by graying in all the boxes on the top of which questions you've answered and which questions you haven't, to make sure that you answer all of them. Oh, looks, we have another question from Jackie. Hi, Jackie. Can I go over SMD? Should I go over SMD? Yeah, I'll go over a little bit about SMD. SMD was basically the overriding umbrella under which I talked about all the studies on porn, on body image, and all that stuff. It's called a sexual media diet. It's all about how the media is promoting sexuality in all sorts of cases. And I don't know if I talked about it, but a lot of this comes from television, comes from rock videos. It comes from a variety of sources, the internet, of course, porn, online porn. All of this is a steady sexual media diet, And we know from all of the studies that I talked about, and I talked about probably 15, 20 studies, that the more sexual media diet you have, the more negative aspects you have. I encourage you to read the chapter that talks about that. There's valuable information in that chapter for the test and also just for life. So I hope that answered your question. We do have a little bit more time if somebody wants to ask a question. Otherwise, we'll do like a minute countdown. And if there's no more questions in a minute, we'll say goodbye and sayonara and auf Wiedersehen and whatever. I'm just going to sit here for a minute and stare at the camera. We have a hedgehog on top of the camera, so I'm staring really at the hedgehog. My tendency is to try to stare at the hedgehog, but you'll notice if you see my eyes shifting off to this side, it means I'm looking at the screen. If you see my eyes shifting off to this side, it means I'm looking at George. So you'll notice that when you notice anybody else on TV who is on Skype, you'll notice that they're often glancing off to the side. That means they're watching themselves on the screen. Anyway, I think we've lasted about a minute. So thank you for your questions. Good luck on the test. I hope everybody gets a perfect score. And I'll see you virtually. If you have any questions, you can always email me. Thanks very much. Sayonara.